Hi, it's Channel Hansport here. We're going to take a look at Frank Zappa's Pedro's Dowry. Now, for some, this is a difficult piece to listen to. It's very dissonant and may even appear to be rudderless with an indeterminate sense of direction. However, on closer inspection, we discover that there is a design. And in this analysis, I'm going to show how themes and melodic fragments are distributed throughout the piece. For example, a theme may be broken up into smaller parts, and those smaller parts may be broken up again, subject to reorchestration, harmonization, and isomalism. Their re-emergence can be either conspicuous or concealed, and these concealed examples will be highlighted to show correlations that can be identified in the score yet difficult to hear in the music. Themes of fragments are not always adjacent or even within close proximity, and their variations undergo a process of contraction or expansion and evolve at different rates. In this diagram, a theme is stated, then divided in half, with each half subject to variation, which is then integrated into new material, which itself is varied throughout. There is no coincidence that this begins to resemble a colder mobile. In the real Frank Zappa book, Zappa explains that, in my compositions, I employ a system of weights, balances, measured tensions, and releases, in some ways similar to Varese's aesthetic. The similarities are best illustrated by comparison to a colder mobile, a multicolored whatchamacallit dangling in space that has big blobs of metal connected to pieces of wire, balanced ingeniously against little metal dingleberries on the other end. Varese knew Calder and was fascinated by these creations. So, in my case, I say a large mass of any material will balance a smaller, denser mass of any material, according to the length of the gizmo it's dangling on and the balance point chosen to facilitate the danglement. Generally, themes and their fragmental derivatives tend to be prominent and are mostly defined by a unison line with relatively static rhythmic and harmonic accompaniment. Whereas non-thematic fragments are concealed and less residual. It's important to realize that these themes and fragments do not constitute an overarching basis for the composition. Instead, they contrast other musical material, providing a sense of unity and coherence in the unfolding of the piece. As mentioned, subsequent derivations of themes are not adjacent and are indicative of long-range association. In the Journal of Music Theory, Strauss, 1987, stressed the importance of an associational model in the analysis of post-tonal music in general, where musical tones separated in time may be associated by a variety of contextual means, including register, timbre, metrical placement, dynamics, and articulation. Associations of this kind draw together elements separated in time and create coherence. The first theme in our analysis is performed by the clavinet in the first two bars of the piece. It is a stutter-like alternation between two notes, separated by pitch interval 8. The theme appears to be more of a local introductory embellishment, but reveals its relative importance later on at bars 24 to 32, where it is extended with augmentation occurring in the rhythm and intervallic structure. The rhythm is stretched, and the play of pitch interval 8 is now in the form of pitch interval 10. In bar 28, the D is ornamented by C-sharp and E, creating a momentary prolongation. The contour in bars 28 to 29 is a larger version of the contour in bar 2, representing further expansion, drawing it out and playing with the tension that preempts bar 31, wherein contains a variation of the preceding two bars. In bars 46 to 48, another theme is introduced that is subsequently divided into two parts, with each part subject to further development. If we consider the theme as a division of two fragments, we notice how each one takes on a new form. In bars 114 to 117, the first fragment of the theme is rhythmically augmented, while the second is repeated with rhythmic variations. The second fragment becomes the source for new thematic material in bars 127 to 130, but takes on more of an accompanying role. Stated consecutively within three different rhythmic units, it is the precursor for a similar idea employed from bar 136, where it is repeated successively. The timbre and rhythm of it is contrasted and varied in relation to its prior instantiation, but this concealment is deceptive and is another example of Zappa's ability to modify existing material that simultaneously shows contrast, yet an inextricable link. Here is a good example of regenerative and expansive procedures where themes become progressively less residual. And as this occurs, these residuals go on to develop their own replicative and derivative forms. This constant state of transformation and variation is key to understanding Zappa's approach to composition. A new theme is introduced at bars 146 to 147, and as before is divided into two thematic fragments, which from bars 153 to 157 are subject to separate developmental procedures. The theme is almost replicated in its entirety in bar 154, followed by a staggered second fragment prolonged by note reiteration of the G sharp and B flat. The second fragment re-emerges at bar 157 at T1. Isomalism is a term that was coined by German musicologist Heinrich Bessler. It has been adapted somewhat to refer to a technique that Zappa uses a lot, which is the note-for-note repetition of the melody, but with variation in the rhythm. Let me show you an example. Here is a basic melody. And here it is again, note-for-note, but with different rhythms. This time, the notes are displaced by octaves, however, the note classes are exactly the same. Here is an example of the technique in Pedro's Dowry. Examples of this technique can be seen in the semiquaver note quintuplet at bar 56, which is an isomelic variation of the quintuplet in bar 55. At bar 59, the quintuplet has now transformed into a non-uplet and exhibits a partial inversion. In bar 101, the sextuplet figure is an extension of the quintuplet in bar 56, with pitch space variation, and the septuplet fragment in bar 102 is pivotal in the sense that it retains part of the initial quintuplet and introduces new material that is developed in bar 111. More examples of isomalism occur between bars 71 to 81, where two different statements are repeated. Firstly, a seven-note melodic fragment maintains its melodic form but is rhythmically varied, and secondly, a larger phrase beginning on the last beat of bar 72 is repeated with rhythmic elongation. Bar 98 to 100 shows an interesting distribution of disjunctive lines that create jagged contours. The initial impression at this point is of a seemingly impenetrable texture. Yet on closer inspection, it reveals further examples of isomalism. The top line in bar 98 is repeated in the trumpet and tuned percussion in bar 100. Quaver note quintuplet in the bass clef of bar 100 is a replication in a different register of the quintuplet sequence from bars 89 to 91. Because these lines are so heavily embedded in close-knit harmony and are also partial to octave complementation, they are rendered virtually imperceptible in corresponding to previous iterations. The next example proves to be problematic in terms of defining its status. As we have already observed, fragments tend to be less prominent than themes. However, here, what starts as a prominent theme is recapitulated in the first instance by a difficult-to-detect isomelic variation, and in the second, a concealed fragment. The first statement of it is at bars 130 to 131. It is supported by variable dyads, which incidentally are the exact same ones derived from the opening four bars of the Pleated Gazelle from 200 Motels. In the Pleated Gazelle, the dyads are played staccato by the piano. However, in this incarnation, they are performed by stroked marimba and flutter-tongued flute.
One night I couldn't get any action after the concert. I went back to the hotel by myself.
The phrase exemplifies the prevalent technique of rhythmic diminution and augmentation, expressing a rapid switch between acceleration and deceleration. In the first instance of the phrase, it is defined and we are in no doubt of its prominence, but when it is reinstated at bars 159 to 160, it is subsumed among a cacophony of orchestration. This procedure pertains to the surreptitious placement of recycled material, reinstantiations of phrases or fragments that are indiscernible in the oral yet hold continuity within the written score. Music theorist Jonathan Bernard discusses a similar occurrence in Ligeti's music, where he cites the composer describing his approach to atmospheres and lontano. Ligeti explains that the pieces have a dense canonic structure, but the inherent polyphony is undetectable in the oral. Instead, one hears an impenetrable texture. Bernard then goes on to pose the following questions. How can we come to terms with this apparent discrepancy between what is written and what is heard? What is the point of composing strict canonic structures that cannot be perceived as such? And if we do not hear this micropolyphony, as Ligeti terms it, then what do we hear? Where Ligeti seems susceptible to visual and tactile parallels, to auditory phenomena to a degree that approaches synesthetic sensitivity, Zappa is more inclined to form parallels with sound and the psychological and physiological effects. This idiosyncratic distribution of themes and fragments is interesting because it aligns with Zappa's concept of universal time, which is everything is happening all of the time, or simultaneous compositional events as measured weights balanced at different locations, or even the compositional analogy of a Calder mobile. Pedro's Dowry also fosters the discussion of music intended for the subconscious. This relates to the re-emergence of previously stated musical material as veiled incarnations. While this is an interesting way to establish continuity, the re-emerging material is so embedded in dense orchestration that it is difficult to notice the musical recurrences. The implication is that one might experience continuity subconsciously. The idea that this could be one of the compositional procedures for unification is most interesting. Resolution is often found at the end of complex rhythmic and melodic patterns. It is usually in the form of a sustained dissonant chord that acts as a resting point counterbalanced by the aforementioned patterns. This approach to tension release is interesting because the moment of stasis is so removed from the preceding rhythmic and melodic episode that whatever impending event occurs next will appear even more dramatic. An example of this is at bars 33 to 38. The suspense builds, and when we arrive at bar 39, a short jagged interjectory melody is played that is reminiscent of the music of Eric Dolphy, made the more salient by flute and vibraphone combination, a particular feature of the Out to Lunch album from 1965. It is an excellent piece of orchestral writing because even though the melody is highly chromatic, it has the effect of resolution from the preceding suspenseful note overlay sequence. However, any sense of resolution is quickly thwarted by the chordal swell that follows, which then leads into the dramatic percussion and brass section. This procedure of heightening tension by means of contrast and texture on already existing dissonance is an excellent example of Zappa's ability to employ weights, balances, measured tensions, and releases.